They all walked away with nothing to say. They just lost their dearest friend and all that he said, and now he was dead. So this was the way it would end. The dreams they had dreamed were not as they'd seemed. Now that he was dead and gone, the garden, the jail, the hammer, the nail, how could a night be so long? Then came the morning, night turned into day, the stone was rolled. The angel, the star, the kings from afar, the wedding, the water, the wine. Now it was done, they'd taken her son, wasted before his time. She knew it was true, she'd watched him die too. She heard them call him just a man, but deep in her heart she knew from the start somehow her son would live again. Then came the morning, night turned
like for him to be in charge, right? He knows how to conduct a service. Been doing it for a long time. Over 1900 years ago, you know, he came day of Pentecost, and he's been doing a good job since. However, some churches don't want the Holy Spirit around, but we do, and we're glad you're here. We appreciate you being in God's house. I have some friends of mine here. I know some, and some I don't know. If you're visiting with us, I don't know. We're glad to have you. But I know Brent and Dwayne, and I think his wife, so I don't know her name. Some I don't know. But if you're visiting with us, we're glad you're here. If I don't know you, God knows you, and that's the most important thing. We're delighted to have you. Pleasure having you. Good to see you folks. Y'all love the Lord around here, don't you?
Amen.
Why'd you come here for? To worship the Lord. And Brother Bob had a little problem, but he's back with us, and he's been motivating around, preaching some since he's had that stroke. But we're glad to have you back, Bob. We're praying for you, and we hope everything goes well for you. When you get through with that thing on your neck, just give it to me and I'll wear it. Yeah. I like them things. I used to wear them. All right. In the book of Romans, I have preached on this many times and referred to it many times, but I have never put it together like I'm going to put it together today. So I'm going to go back. Actually, Romans chapter 1 is where we'll be, and it'll be 1 verse 16 through 20, actually. And I have preached on Jerusalem from 18 through, but I'd never tied the two together until this week. And so we're going to be a little repeat on the latter part of it. But the first part of it, I've never tied it together. And we're going to do that this morning. For the gospel is God's righteousness revealed from faith to faith. That's part of the scripture I'll be reading. And it talks about the righteous will live by faith. And that's Romans 1:17. We'll get to that in just a moment. But what I'm going to talk about is God's righteousness, and also I'm going to talk about not only God's righteousness, but God's wrath, and how God reveals His righteousness and how God reveals His wrath. They're both together, and I'd never had really seen this till I did an in-depth study on Romans chapter 1, verse 16. I got 19, but it's actually through 20. And so, first of all, let me define the word righteousness. I put it on the screen that you can see it. And the word wrath. The word righteousness, it has a meaning. And so you could probably have different type meanings, but this is a good meaning of the word righteous. It is being in right standing with God. Righteousness is being in right standing with God. And I believe only a true born-again Christian, saved by grace, can be in right standing with God. Else, if you're not saved, you're like Adam, right? The first time Adam ate the fruit, he died, right? Not physically, spiritually. He died in his spirit. He died. No more recognition of God. He didn't know God in that sense. Personally had a relationship with him, and God didn't know him. He's just a sinner now, right? That happened in the Garden of Eden. And so a true born-again child of God can have a right standing with God. Now we have to work on that. It's not easy to keep me straight, right? I have this Adamic nature, and so do you. We all have that. And everywhere I go, it goes too, right? and the devil will do everything in his power to try to pull me away from God. You know, he hated God. Satan did. He tried to had a coup in heaven and tried to overthrow God and his powerful glory, and he didn't get that done. Michael and the angel fought against the devil and his angel and kicked him out of heaven. And now we have been having to contend with him all these years. Ever since I become awareness of my sinfulness, ever since I came to the knowledge of knowing right from wrong, then I had to put up with him. And when I got saved, I've put up worse with him than I ever have. You know, after I got saved. You know, he didn't bother me too much when I was living for him because he had me. But now it's a different ballgame, right? So it's a difficult situation to stay in right standing with God. I have to work on it every day. I have to read the Bible every day. I have to study every day and not just read it. I got to study it. I got to pray. I got to worship and serve. That's how I stay in right standing. Now, the word wrath, it's an intense anger. Yeah. And it really usually is of epic scale. I mean, it's a big thing. It ain't just, I'm just a little angry. God really got angry at the people in Noah's day, right? The very imaginations of them. That's anger and wrath. I mean, that's epic anger. That's epic wrath. He said, I'm going to destroy you. And he did. Never rained before. You aware of that? There was just a mist that come up and drew dew. I'll get it right in a minute. Dew watered it. And so it just come up and watered. So there wasn't no rain. And they thought, this guy's crazy. What's he talking about? Rain. Building a boat. There's no, never rain. And God's anger was so against them. So against them. And he wiped out the whole nation, whole world. Probably a few million people, probably. We don't know. And only 8 people survived that. How many people you think is going to heaven compared to those that are going to hell? You know, broad is the way that leads to destruction, and many be there going thereat. Narrow is the way that leads to heaven, and few there be that find it. If only eight got on that boat and survived that, you know, there's just going to be a few survive the fire that God sends down on this earth, according to the Word of God. So, it's intense anger. Now, the revelation of God's righteousness. Now, let's look at it in its context. Because I don't take Scripture out of context. I leave it in context, and I explain the verses of Scripture through research and through the Holy Spirit. For Paul said, and he said in verse 16, "For I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ." You guys are not ashamed of that, are you? I'm not ashamed of it, he's simply saying. He's simply saying, I don't have feelings of shame or embarrassment over the gospel of Christ. I do not have those feelings. I don't have humiliation over it. I believe the gospel is good news. Wonderful news. And I believe that Christ is the only way to heaven. He's not one entity. He's the only entity. And he says, I'm not ashamed of that. What is the opposite? When you look at the word shame, embarrassed, What is it? What is an antonym of it? You know, not a synonym. An antonym is opposite of it. Is ashamed. Happy is a good one. Happy is opposite of embarrassment. Happy is opposite of, disgrace. I'm happy. I'm happy in the Lord this morning. Yeah, I'm not ashamed. I feel like I'm doing the most important thing going on in Blount County today. One of them. Now, all over Blount County, there's different preachers that believe the Bible. There's some that don't. I don't pray for them anyway. They don't need prayer. They need to be saved. I pray for these who believe the gospel of Christ. I pray for them. I pray for my pastor friends here in North Carolina and different places that preach the gospel. And the most important thing that's going on in Blount County today is the preaching of the gospel of Christ. Not ashamed of it. Not ashamed of it. Sad. And then he gives a reason for he's not ashamed of it. Look at it. For, that speaks of a reason. For it, the gospel, is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that what? Believes. Well, let me ask you this. It is the power, it is the dunamis. That's where the word power comes from. Dunamis, which means you get the word dynamite. It's powerful. It can change a sinner into a saint. It can change a drug addict into a Christian. It can change no matter what kind of you, murderer, killer, doesn't make any difference. It can change you into a saint. It's powerful. The power of God. And how salvation means deliverance. Aren't you glad this morning that you've been delivered? I've been rescued. I've been rescued. I was on the wrong track. I was going down the wrong road, and Jesus rescued me. I'm so glad today that the gospel of the good news was, Jesus, I love you. I love you. I died for you. It's just kind of heard this voice. It's just, I died for you. You, won't you accept me as your Lord? That's all it's saying. I believe in the conviction of the Holy Spirit. I believe that the Holy Spirit is the greatest power this world's ever known. I was just living it up, enjoying the pleasures of sin, until that day the Holy Spirit came into my heart. And boy, it was different then. I began to be aware of my lostness and my wretchedness. And I began to be aware of the love that God had for me. And so, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it's the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes. Now, let me ask you this question. Is there a difference between a head belief and a heart belief? So, if you were to go into the streets of Maryville or go down to Mall or go to Walmart, wherever you want to go, and just ask, do you believe in Jesus? Do you believe that there was a Jesus? I would say the majority of the people in Blount County would say, yes, I believe that there was a Jesus. I believe he lived. So that's what we call an intellectual concept of Jesus, right? Intellectual concept. So there's a lot of people got that. And sometimes they say, well, that's good enough. I just believe that. Oh, no, that's not good enough. You've got to move about 18 inches from the head to the heart. You got to move it from up here in here. And then it's a different ball game then, right? So intellectually, I believe there's a Jesus Christ. And I did. I never was. You know, I think it takes more faith to be an atheist than it does to be a Christian. Do you believe that? It takes a lot of faith to be an atheist. It does. It takes a lot of faith to be a Christian. But anyway, the power of God in somebody that believes. So I've got this heart belief in here. I believe it in my heart. To the Jew first, and to the Greek, and to the Gentile. Doesn't matter to me whether I was first. We can be second. It don't matter to me. He comes to his own people first. They rejected it. And he comes to us Gentiles. That's what a Greek means, Gentile, non-Jewish. And then verse number 17, for therein, in this, you could translate that word, in this is the righteousness of God. In what? Go back to not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Don't be ashamed of the Lord. Now, the Lord's been ashamed of me, I'm sure, a few times. And even Peter was ashamed of Christ, right? Peter said, I don't know him. No, I don't know him. And been with him for 3 years, he didn't know him. And herein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. So this ashamedness, the gospel, the power of God unto salvation, we believe in our heart. Because Romans 10:9 says that if thou wilt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be what? Saved. There ain't no mites and maybes about it, right? If you really believe that, you're saved, right? So I have that. And do you have that? Do you really have that kind of belief? Have you really moved it from your head to your heart? That's the point. And it says, therefore, the righteousness of God, the right standing of God, is revealed from faith to faith, okay? And from Abraham to me, and from Abraham to you. It started out with this man called Abraham. It was counted on him for righteousness. When you go into Romans chapter 4, verse number 22, it was imputed on him. It was imputed. It was put on his account. His faith in Jesus Christ and God, or through God, through Jesus Christ. But he said, Abraham, you're going to have a baby. I'm 100 years old. You can't have no baby. Sarah's 90. She can't have a baby. But he believed that. He believed it. And said, okay, I'm going to believe this. I don't know when God gave him the promise. It was before 100 years old, I guess. I don't know. Maybe it was before that. Maybe it was. I don't know. But it doesn't matter. God said, you're going to have a child. And he believed that. And it was imputed on him, put on his account. And so God, that was righteousness. He was in right standing with God. So therein the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith from Abraham unto us. And just as the Jews are, you know, they look at him, hey, he's the father of the Jewish nation. You know, the Jews believe that. But he's not only the father of the Jewish nation, he's the father of the Gentile nation, right? He's our father, right? I'm looking at a house full of Gentiles. Is he your heavenly father? Yeah, he's your heavenly father. See, he is not only just the father of the Jews, he's the father of us too. Because we got the same faith he had. Here's the thing, that Abraham, he had looked down the lane of life way into the future and said, I believe that God is going to send his son to die for my sins. He had to believe that. The Messiah. I look back and said, I believe he already has. You look back and say he already has. What's the difference in faith? No difference, ladies and gentlemen, to look forward or to look backward, but thank God it has happened. It has happened. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. And it is written, the just shall live by what? Faith. Revealed by faith and reproduced by faith. I thought that was pretty fitting. It was revealed to Abraham. It was reproduced in him, and also us Gentiles. So we're reproducing the faith. We still have faith in the Lord Jesus Christ from faith to faith. Thank God. Thank God. There ain't many people believing in him today like they used to. Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4. That's an Old Testament reference to it. The just shall live what? By faith. Habakkuk. He's one of the minor prophets, and he wrote about that. The faith, the just. Just means declared innocent. We're justified. Justified means to be declared innocent. That means we've been acquitted. We're not guilty. When you put your faith in Jesus Christ as the Messiah, the Son of the living God, God says you're justified. You are free from all guilt. Free from all guilt. The just shall live by faith. The justified shall live by faith. The eyes of your understanding. This is one of the greatest verses in the scripture, in the Word of God. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened. Now, my physical eyes, they take no doubt in probably 20,000 pictures a day and give them to me in living color. Yours does too. Your eyes take no less than 20,000 pictures a day and give them to you in living color. That's not what he's talking about. The eyes of your understanding. So this is an interesting word in our King James Version Bible. But if you were to read it in a Greek text, it would be a little different word. And it reads like this. The eyes of your cardia. That's the Greek word. The eyes of your cardia being enlightened. We get the word cardiac from heart, right? You got a cardiac arrest. That means you've had a heart attack, right? The point is, he's saying, the eyes of your heart. It's not these physical eyes. It's not that, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened. The eyes of your heart being enlightened. And only the Holy Spirit can do that. Only the Holy Spirit can give you revelation. I didn't do anything about my life until the Holy Spirit put light in there. I didn't do anything about it. But light came in and revelation came. And there I was enlightened. And then it says that you may know what is the hope anticipated. Anticipation, that's what the word hope means. And you may know what is the hope, the anticipation of his calling, invitation. I don't believe you get saved just any time you want to. Right? I believe in the divine calling. I believe Almighty God invites you into his kingdom. I believe God issues an invitation to you. That's the calling. I invite you into my kingdom. I want you to be a part. Many are called. Many are called. Many are invited, but few are accepted. Why does he call a whole bunch and not accept everybody? Because God looks on the what? Heart. He looks on the inside. He knows whether you mean business or not, right? Man, I was arguing with God. God, you know, I'm playing baseball with these guys. I like to run around with these guys. You know, I don't know about this thing. Now, what I'm going to have to do, he said, it's either me or them. It was like the voice said, it's either me or them. Well, I gave them up and accepted Jesus Christ, and it's been a good journey. Amen. I'd do it again. I'd do it all over again. Well, I wouldn't take nothing for my journey now. Amen. It's been a wonderful experience. He called me into his... Do you know, ladies and gentlemen, we all kin? Do you understand that we're all related? We all have different fathers, unless you have one of your kids here, children here, and you're the father of them. But we've all got one father. His name is Jehovah, not Allah. Jehovah, Almighty God, underived existing one. He's our father. And I can say, Brenda, you're my sister. Reba, you're my sister. Angela, you're my sister. Earl, you're my brother. Jade, you're my brother. Sonny, you're my brother. We're related, amen. See, we come from the same womb. You know what that womb is called? Born again. Woo. But let me tell you, you don't just decide to change your mind. It's a new birth. It's something on the inside. Comes on the inside. Changes you on the inside. I tell you what, I'll never forget that moment that I got born again. I didn't know what... I was the most backward and bashful boy in Rockford, Tennessee. I didn't think I could ever walk down that aisle because it was a Sunday afternoon and I had to go to church that night. Like what I think it was Brother Jeremiah said, yeah, I had a drug problem. Said, my mom and dad drug me to church every Sunday morning, every Sunday night, every Wednesday night. I had a drug problem too. They drugged me to church. I knew I was going to church on Sunday night, and I knew that I had to make it public. I knew I had to walk down that aisle and tell that preacher I got saved today. I thought I would die. I thought I'll have a heart attack. I'd never stood before people. Now, I could play basketball, football, baseball. I could play. It didn't bother me to get in front of a crowd. But to get and say something before people was the most horrifying thing. I ever did. And I'm standing back there, Orville Valentine. Oh, what a great preacher. A little crippled hand, had that Bible in his hand. And he come out and said, he invited us all to get saved. And anybody got anything you want to say? And I said, Lord, I'm not sure I'm going to go down there. And he was like, Holy Spirit, yeah, you are. He did kind of nudge me out. He nudged me. I kind of pushed me, and I walked down the side that aisle. And I got down there, and I told him, I said, hey, Orville, I got to say, bless God, that was the greatest confession ever made in my life. I confess Jesus Christ as my Lord and my Savior. And you know what? I'd like to get saved again, wouldn't you? I know you can't. I'm eternal salvation guy. I believe you get it. If you really get it, you get it all. But I what an experience that was. That was a wonderful experience that I had. I felt clean. I felt good. And I didn't think God would ever call me to preach. When he did, I said, God, you made a mistake. I can't do that. No way. This month's been 57 years ago. Oh, what a journey it's been. I'm telling you, 57 years ago, I think the greatest calling is calling to be saved. Now, that's the greatest calling of all. And there's another calling to be what God wants you to be, whether it's deacon, preacher, singer, whatever God, but the call to serve him, that's a great calling. Next to being saved. And some of you have got that calling. And you're serving God. That's wonderful. That's wonderful. So his call, and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance is in the saints. Oh my goodness. We got billionaires. I mean, they flaunt their billionaires. I look at these people and I see what they got, you know. All that stuff, you know, oh, they're rich and all the richest people in the world. And boy, they. But you know what? They can't take it with them. They ain't going to take it with them. But we've got an inheritance. God is owns a cattle on 1,000 hills, right? He said, all the silver and all the gold's mine. And as a matter of fact, in the book of Revelation, the streets are transparent gold. We're going to walk on that. And so, we have an inheritance. We're a joint heir with Christ Jesus. I don't know what that means, but I'm sure we're going to find out someday. I'm going to be there when the wheel is red. When the wheel is red, I'm going to be there, and I hope you go too. Amen. What an inheritance. Oh, bless God. You know, I told somebody the other day, who was that? Young person. Anyway, I was talking, he's talking, complaining about this and complaining about that. I said, how old are you? He told me, I said, it'll get worse. Don't look for it to get any better. I've told Rob that a lot. I said, Rob, you're a half a century old now. He said, you just wait. It'll get worse. And it will. And so that's the way life is. And we're getting older and all these aches and pains. And young people, you'll have aches and pains you didn't know existed when you get 50, 60, 70. Oh, Lord. It's going to be terrible. Physically. But you just wait a minute here. Glory to God. One of the most thrilling things, if you can ever get this concept, if you can ever get this, this will really set you on fire. That Jesus Christ, born of a virgin, became a human being. He was hungry. When he was hungry, he ate. When he was tired, he rested. When he was this or that, he worked as a carpenter. He did all the things that a human being did and does. And so he did all of that. And he was a human being, right? But yet he was the God-man. The physical part of him was the human part. And he became a human for what reason? Why would he come down here, down to this earth, and become a human being? Why would he do that? He wanted Adam, who messed up, the first Adam messed up. The second Adam is reference to Jesus. The first Adam messed up. The second Adam was reference to Jesus. You'll find that in 1 Corinthians 15:45. You'll find. So in Adam, we all die. But in Jesus, he said, I'm going to fix up what Adam messed up. And he fixed up what Adam messed up. Now, we're still human. But then when he came, he went to the cross, died on the cross, was buried, rose again, conquered death, hell, and the grave, and he became now a celestial being, right? He's back to being God in the spirit. He had a body, but he still, he died as a human being, but he come back alive as a celestial being because he could walk through the wall, right? He didn't have to open the door and go out of it. He could change position. He could be here right there and be over yonder right there. So now he's back in that celestial state. For 33 years, he was a human being. And now after the death, he become a celestial being. Marvelous by the power of Almighty God, and God raised him up from the grave. Now, put it all together. We're a terrestrial being. We're a human being. And we died spiritually. We died spiritually when we got saved. We died spiritually to the dead to the world. Let me rephrase that. We're dead to the world. We're not dead in sins and trespasses. We're dead to them. Being dead in them means you're lost. Being dead to them means you're saved and you're dead to trespasses. So I'm dead to this world. I'm dead to the world. But I'm alive to who? God. Christ. I'm alive to Him. So He became a terrestrial being, and later, through the death and burial and resurrection, He became a celestial being. Now, we are terrestrial beings. We're going to die, and we're going to perish, and we're going to go where? To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So therefore, He became a terrestrial being that you and I could become a celestial being. He was a terrestrial being for 33 years, and now I've been a terrestrial being for you. It ain't none of your business. No, I don't care. 77 years I've been a terrestrial being. I'm just waiting for my change to come. Amen. Some of you are older than I am. Some of you are older than dirt. Anyway, we're just old. We're getting there. But we're going to be, whoo-wee, glory to God. It's a make a pistopagan shout, man, let me tell you. When Pat and Eddie brought me a picture. They brought me a picture. And I'd seen the picture. And it's a picture of an old woman, Barbara. You know what she said? Let me tell you folks what she said Wednesday night. Now I want to tell you this. This is the funniest thing I've laughed about ever since I said it. I was preaching about the angels. I'll get back to the message in just a minute. I was preaching about the angels, you know, that they're not married and not given in marriage, you know. And Barbara was something. She didn't hear me when I said, Barbara, that means we won't be married. She didn't hear me. And I said, Barbara, it means we won't be married. She looked at me and said, okay. That's what she said. Okay. Well, we won't be married. But that was a classic answer. But this old woman, now let me get back to this old woman's picture. She's old on this side, but when she went through the door, she met Jesus on the other side. And boy, there's a transformation took place on the other side. Ooh, from this, oh, glory to God. There's going to be a transformation from this side to that side. Amen. Whew, glory to God. What a transformation it'll be when we step into glory. I've heard some preachers tell alone said, I think we'll be about 33. I don't care what we'll be. It'll be glorious. Amen. No more aches and no more pains, right? No more hospitals and no more doctor bills. No more. We will be celestial. I love that. Oh, Lord, I ain't going to get through this morning, am I? No. That's all right. That's all right. I want you to look at, I read a lot about Richard Dawkins, only just to say, oh dear God, this poor man. He said religion teaches the dangerous nonsense that death is not the end. What do you think about that guy? Good heavens. He wrote The God Delusion. He wrote the book The God Delusion. And the Book of Reason or something. No, not really the real Book of Reason. That was Thomas Paine wrote that. But anyway, he doesn't believe in God. He says when you die, you just go back to dirt, and that's all it is. Yeah, yeah. Highly educated, goes all over the world, sells his book, and deceives so many people, and there's multitudes of people in hell because they believe this guy. They believe this guy. Well, what does God think about him? Yeah, that's right, Sandy. In Psalm 14 and 1, here's what God says. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. So, would you say he qualifies for that? Well, I've heard him. Yes, I've heard his debates. I check on his debates. I listen to debates of atheists. I do. You say, preacher, you shouldn't. Oh, I do. Because I want to know what I'm saying when I preach. I want to make sure I got his quote. I got his quote. That's what I didn't say it. He said it. The revelation of God's wrath. Okay, that's the revelation of God's righteousness. Now, verse number 18. For the wrath of God is revealed from it. Boy, this is good stuff right here. Yeah, I believe I can get it in here. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and uprightness of men, humanity. That's in the masculine and feminine genitive. It means human. It means man and woman or human being. You could translate that word. Against all ungodliness and righteousness of humanity who hold the truth in unrighteousness. And I wanted to put that on. Hold the truth means suppresses the truth. Puts down by force of authority. And that's what they're doing today. They don't accept the truth. But I want to ask you this question. Who reveals the wrath of God? Did you find it in that verse? Who reveals the wrath of God? Look at it, study it. You tell me who reveals the wrath of God. Who? God. God reveals. Preacher Merrill don't reveal the wrath of God. God reveals it. Bob, you don't reveal the wrath of God. I mean, we say it, but who really reveals it? God. God reveals wrath to every human being. He does it. So don't tell me that Richard Dawkins don't know about the wrath of God. He does know about it because God reveals it to every human being. He reveals it. They know it. Right, that's what it said. Against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth and unrighteousness. So he qualifies for that. He reveals God. God reveals it. Now you got to keep that in mind now. God reveals it. 2 Timothy 3:7. Ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Our technology today, from the time I was just a young boy to now, blows my mind. Blows my mind, right? Ever learning. Boy, I mean, humanity, it blows my mind at the intellect of humanity. Men and women are brilliant, and they're brilliant. And yet, they never have discovered the truth. They've never really got the truth. They're learning, but they're not learning much about the Bible. They're not learning that. They're suppressing the Bible. Ever learned, never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Because that which may be known of God is manifest, revealed. Where is God revealed his wrath at? In who? Who's them? That's unrighteous people, ungodly people, lost people. Are we on the same page here? Okay. Because that which may be known of God is manifested, revealed in them, for who showed it to them? God. God shows it to them. God shows his wrath. Not me. I preach on hell. I believe in it. God gives me a message. I believe in it. I'll preach it. But God shows that. It's the Spirit of the Lord that shows people the wrath of God. It's all right there. Look at verse number 20. For the invisible things of him, that's God, from the creation of the world are clearly seen. How do you see invisible things? How can a person see invisible things? What it says, from the invisible things of him, from the creation of the world, are clearly seen, being not only seen, but understood by the things that are, what? Made? I've taught you all this before. You all Hillcrest people know what I'm talking about. And so, understood, comprehended. I got it. I've got it. I understand it now. Even, here's what, that they know. Even his eternal power. Wait a minute. They don't believe in him. They believe in Big Bang Theory. They believe in, evolution. No, God revealed it to them. God revealed it to them. Reveals his wrath to them. And yet, they should have clearly seen, and I'm going to show you some things that they can convince them. The things that are made, even his eternal power, Godhead, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, should understand that. We don't have no problem with that, do we? Do I understand it? No, but I don't have no problem with it. I believe God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. In other words, the point that's made there is there's always been one part of God on this earth from the time of creation to now. God the Father in the Old Testament, God the Son, Jesus in the New Testament, and God the Holy Spirit in the church age. All three have been on this earth at one time. That's the Godhead. So that they are what? Without excuse. When people die and go to hell, they're without excuse. Because God had warned them. God had warned them of his wrath. God doesn't send anybody to hell. They send themselves. God doesn't send anybody. They send themselves. They're without excuse. I want you to look at this. This is the solar system. You all believe in the solar system? You ever seen it? Some of you looked in a telescope? Anybody? Some of you? Well, I never have. But it's up there, right? It's up there. That's what he's saying, things that are seen. So we got these intelligent, astronomers, physicists, and they look at all this. You would think that should change their mind, right? You'd look at Mercury. That's the closest one to the sun, smallest planet of all. You know how long it takes Mercury to circle the sun? It takes Mercury to circle the sun 88 days. You know what speed it takes? Now, I've got this all from the scientists. I mean, I'm not that smart. And I'm not sure they are. I don't know where they get that at. But they come up with this. 88 days. And it travels at 110,000 miles per hour. Wow, boy. Daytona Beach would like to see that, wouldn't it? 110,000 miles an hour that it goes around. 88 days it circles the sun. You can't live there. It's too hot. Right? And you got... the next one is Venus, and you can't live there. It's too hot. Don't know a whole lot about it. But Earth, you got Earth there. And Earth is the only one that's got oxygen on it, right? These other planets don't have oxygen on it. They see these things. I'm letting you see them. I'm showing you these things to let you know that the Bible's up to date. The Bible's relevant with every culture. So, the Earth has got oxygen. That's amazing how that happens. I've told you that before, how we get oxygen. Carbon dioxide comes out. We're in the process of making oxygen right now. Because that carbon dioxide that we're exhaling, it goes out, and the animals are out there. They're out there breathing, and therefore when we go out them doors, we can say, oh, thank God for the animals. The carbon dioxide, they breathe. Now we got oxygen because that transformation comes through the leaves, and then we got oxygen. Don't tell me there ain't no God. Don't tell me there is no God. And we're going 67,000 miles an hour. Takes 365 days a year for us to get around the sun. Sun don't move. We call it sunrise and sunset. That's really not right. The sun don't set and the sun don't rise. The earth tilts 23 degrees. That gives us all of our weather and everything. Years and time and everything. 23 degrees. The earth, the sun doesn't set. It doesn't move. It stays the same. We're going around 365. I'm glad that we're at this part of it now. I love springtime. I'm glad that we got around here in front of the sun this way because God is blessed. Ain't it a beautiful time of the year? It's beautiful. Now, so all of this is what he's saying. They can see this. We got these guys that look at this. They studied every day. And they say, well, I think we can live on Mars. And they're going to move up there. Yeah, they're going to move up there. There's people signing up to live on Mars. I'm going to go further than Mars, ain't we? We're not going to stop at Mars. We're going to go past Mars when we go to heaven. Yeah, Mars. And then Saturn and space travel and Jupiter and Uranus and Neptune. And what about little old Pluto down here? You can't live in there. You'd freeze to death there. when you look at this, it's just a beautiful thing. You know, Pluto is the father's planet of the solar system, and it travels 10,000 miles an hour. You know how long it takes Pluto to circle the sun? 248 years. What'd that do for you? Say, I'm not interested. Well, that's just what God said. I mean, that's said, when you see these things, you know, to understand that. And if people die without and go to hell, they were aware of this. I guarantee you, there's books, there's documentation on it. You can read it anywhere. I got it. You can read it. And if you die and go to hell as a result of not believing, I mean, the guy in Amazon. The guy in Amazon, a lot of people says, oh, well, he's never heard Billy Graham preach. He's never heard a missionary. And some of them never heard missionaries. But God has revealed himself through nature. Yet God wouldn't let them go to heaven without being born again. God reveals the wrath of God in every human being, no matter whether you're in the Amazon or whether you're in New York City. God reveals it to them. And they got to make a choice. They got to make a choice. So, this is what he's talking about when he said invisible things seen from the creation. God put that up there, and it wasn't no Big Bang Theory. God put it up there. Because that when they knew God, now here, they come to the knowledge of the truth. Those people that have the Hubble telescope, is that the name of it? Hubble telescope, and they look through that, so they see all that, and then they come up with all their opinions about it, you know, oh, it's just a Big Bang Theory, all that stuff. Because when they knew God, they glorified him not as God. But we're doing that this morning. We're glorifying him as God because we believe he's the creator, right? God is the creator. He created this enormous earth that we live on. We're just one of nine planets. And thank God, we believe that. Neither were thankful. They weren't thankful when they understood it. Become vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was what? Darkened. What does that mean? Light, salvation. Dark, sin. They become sin. They become so wickeder. Now, and I said this a while ago, got a little hurt heart, but I believe it. I want you to say it. I'm convinced. I am totally convinced it takes more faith to be an atheist than it does to be a Christian. 2 Corinthians 4:4, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them that believe what? Not. And so he's done a masterful job of blinding the minds of our people. Lest, little word, L-E-S-T, means for fear that the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, and this is light, this is the glorious light of the gospel of Christ, what? Should shine, who is the image of God, this talks about the image of God, shine unto them, right? But the devil's got them blinded, and they can't see. Thank God the Holy Spirit took the blindness away, and I saw the light, and I'm a believer, and you're a believer today. Thank God for that. Now, the conclusion. The wrath of God, John 3:36. He that believeth on the Son has everlasting life. You're a believer, you got everlasting life. And he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides on him. God reveals righteousness. God reveals wrath. The love of God, John 1:48. He that loves not knows not God, for God is what? Love. God's love. I got to finish on a good positive note. God is love. It is your choice which to choose, right? You got the privilege of choosing this morning. If you're here and you're not saved, you've got the choice of choosing. You've got the choice of choosing whether you're going to accept Christ or reject Christ. But let me give you something to think about on this next phrase. I want you to look at it. Remember this. Choices have consequences. Take that home with you. Choices have consequences. You make the right choice, the consequence is God is glory, live in His house. You make the wrong choice, you will experience the wrath of God forever and ever, ever in eternal hell forever and ever if you're not saved. That's your choice. And that's the consequence. God reveals righteousness and God reveals wrath on the inside. Stand with me for prayer. Father, we love you. We love your word with all of our hearts. And God, thank you for the privilege this morning of standing here at Hillcrest Baptist Church and preaching the gospel to these people here that I love. And Father, we have visitors and we love them and we're glad they're here, God. But I want to share the truth, God. Father, you know the truth will stand when the world's on fire. And God, we know that time is running out, God. And I said Wednesday night, I said, you know, the question I heard David Jeremiah say, one of my great preachers I love to hear, he said, the question's been asked, has God give up on America? And he said, that's the wrong question. Has America give up on God? And he said, yes, and I totally agree with him. We have give up on you, God. We've give up on you. But God, I know, and I believe the next prophetic event will be the rapture of the church. I believe we're waiting on that to come. So Jesus, if there's anyone in this building, anyone, God, that's not a Christian, Lord, I pray that you reveal your wrath to them. And hopefully, God, they'll say, hey, I want to ask Christ to come into my heart. I want to be saved this morning. Right now, Holy Father, I'll turn it over to you. You know how to, if you don't convict them, it won't happen. I can't convict them. I've tried to convince them. I've tried to convince people here of the wrath of God. But God, if you don't convince them, convict them, it ain't going to happen. If you have brought conviction into the life of someone here, you've showed them your wrath, I want you to show them your love. And I can show them your love through the Scriptures. I can do that. I can't show them your wrath, but I can show them your love through the Scriptures. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, Earl.
177. Are you washed in the blood? Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Garments spotless, are you white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
God, have your way, Lord.
Yes, God. this is God's service. I mean, this is God showed you something this morning.
Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? When the bridegroom cometh, will your robe be white, pure and white in the blood of the Lamb? Will your soul be ready for the mansion's bright and be washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the souls unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Amen.
Now, right on, you said that 57 years ago was the first sermon I did on this day. I didn't know it. Amen. I'm glad I'm still preaching the word.
Amen.
I wouldn't give this dime a dozen for a man don't stand and preach the word. Let me tell you this in closing. Suppose you went to your doctor, and the doctor said to you, I heard this illustration. Go to the doctor, you got cancer. You ain't got long to live. It's really bad. You know. Really, really bad. So we took, we run the test on you guys. This is bad. The doctor said, well, we're not going to do anything. We're not going to do anything. That's your goal. We got different things to do, but it's not going to do anything. What would you say to that doctor?